Hi, this is Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com. We thought we would take you on a quick floral update of what's blossoming in our garden right now. And one of the things that we're noticing is that our sunflowers, which have been planted by the birds and the squirrels, are not as huge as they usually are. Usually we would have heads that were, three or four times this large. And they're also blossoming way earlier than they usually do. I think it's the weather, but we don't know.
And as you said, all of these here were planted by the squirrels. We didn't plant any of these sunflowers.
No.
I mean, many years ago, your father gave you some Russian sunflower seeds.
Right. And those were 14 feet tall, and the heads on them were like this large. And over the years, we still get some of those. Some of them just are smaller, and some of them don't come up at all. It depends on who plants the seeds, if it's the squirrels or the birds, and who eats them once they get on the ground. But they do plant themselves, too, because you see that one has now fallen over, and if we didn't pick it up or take the heads off, those seeds would fall to the ground and the mice and the birds and the squirrels would eat them, but they always miss some, and those are the ones that grow. Let's go take a look at some of the other things. Now, this isn't actually a flower, and no, we have not planted this. This is regular old milkweed that you find growing out in the countryside. We let a few of ours continue to grow here. They planted themselves, because this is what the monarch butterflies use when they are ready to lay their eggs. They lay the eggs on the underside of the leaves, and then when the baby caterpillars hatch, they eat these. This is what gives them that bitter taste that the birds know, because of the coloration of the caterpillars. Don't eat them, they taste terrible. That comes from the milkweed. And each year, the monarchs, we're told, come back to the same place where they were hatched, even though the ones that come back have never been here. These are the seed pods. If you leave them on long enough, and you see that's the white milky juice that comes out of them. But inside are all these seeds, and these are the ones that develop the little fluff on the end like a dandelion, and they fly all over. Now, I will remove these pods before they go to seed, because I don't want 10,000 of these growing here. But that won't stop them, because they have a root in there too that connects them all, so they'll be back. As many of you may know, liatris is one of my favorite landscaping plants. It's hardy, it's cute, it's sustainable, it's easy to control if you don't like it to get all over the place. I myself will take the heads off of the ones that are done and just take all the seeds and plant them wherever I find them, wherever I want them to come up next year. They grow, they start blossoming at the bottom, or excuse me, at the top, and they work their way down to the bottom. Most plants will blossom from the bottom and go to the top. But these are just, I mean, they're so strong and healthy and happy, and they're such a beautiful color. They work in sun and they work in shade, and they work in the cold and they work in the droughts, and I mean, they're just wonderful. And here's a white one. Where did that one come from? I don't know. I didn't plant this white one.
It's an albino.
It's a mutation. So I will take the seeds from this one for sure and sprinkle those in so that I have a combination of purple and white.
Yeah, and then you've got your little...
These are, what are these? Coreopsis. This is one form of coreopsis. Again, a very happy plant, a very tough plant. Stays in its little clump. It will spread, it'll get bigger and bigger, but it stays in its clump. And if you don't like it, you can just pull it out and put it someplace else. All of these seeds that you see going on right here, this is all dill. And this planted itself also. There's going to be thousands more dill plants if I don't take off the heads very shortly. I just love it because it smells like pickles.
Oh yeah, it is fragrant. I mean, I smell it over here.
Yes. And these are what I've used now in my my squash plantings. And because of research that people have shared with us, I'm guessing that what the dill does is it disguises the smell of the squash plants so that the squash bugs can't find it. And it works like a charm so far in keeping the squash healthy. So I'll just come around, and even if the heads are gone to seed, or just I take the leaves, stick them in there with your squash plants, get them down as far as you can to the ground, and everybody seems to like it. The bees don't mind it, and the squash bugs hate it. Some of you may be familiar with hardy hibiscus. That's the hibiscus that grows in our climate, which is just amazing, and has this fantastic flower to it. I mean, just look at this. I mean, that is almost the size of a dinner plate. This will be done today. This is a one-day wonder here. But you can see that all of these blossoms are waiting their turn.
I mean, there's hundreds on here.
Yes.
Right now.
So today, this is open. Tomorrow it'll be gone. It'll just be all folded up and ready to drop down.
Well, you've got a couple of more here who are just about ready to open. They may even open today yet.
They might. They like sun. The more sun, the better. We have some that are now being shaded by our peach trees, and they are way, way, way behind this one.
Well, but we may have to move those.
We'll have to move them and put them into a sunnier place. But they too, they start out, they go down, they die down to the ground in the wintertime. And they don't come up again until about Father's Day. So you have to be real patient, and you have to remember what you've planted so that you don't start digging thinking, oh, nothing's here, nothing's coming up. You have to remember, oh, my hibiscus is there. It's gonna be coming, I have to wait for it. So it's well worth the wait.
And we have it in red and pink too, right?
Yes. This is phlox. Not to be confused with the bad phlox, the pseudo phlox, they might say, that shows up earlier in the season, probably about May or June. This is the true phlox that is not invasive. It smells wonderful and comes back year after year. Not a plant that requires a lot of care or worry. I don't know that we've watered this plant at all. It comes in different colors. We have a white one. We have this color, purple. They just smell so good. And this little area just keeps getting a little bigger and a little bigger each year, so that's nice. Makes a beautiful backdrop. These snapdragons and these asters have planted themselves. Several years back, I planted aster seeds, and every year since, I've been able to just let them blossom and go to seed at the very end of the year, and they will reseed themselves. Same with the snapdragons. I moved a couple of them from the back where they were seeding themselves, and here they've done it again. They're beautiful. This is my Japanese peony, or fern leaf peony as some people call it. Let me get these on here, wood sorrel. I left on a majority of the leaves, the seeds this year, in hopes of getting some seed so that I could plant it next year. Let me just take this off. Maybe not. Wait a minute. I was looking at it the other day. I wasn't seeing a whole lot of seeds inside. And see, there should be all sorts of little seeds in there.
And you purposely let this go to seed.
I let it, yes. Hoping. Either they didn't form a lot of seeds, or something got in there and made a feast out of my peony seeds again. We'll have to see if maybe some of them came around. One can only hope. And this is the white version of the phlox that we were talking about earlier. Also, spectacular smells. They look pretty together. Very nice. Remember, this is not the one that grows wild when you're driving down the highway and you see all these beautiful flowers. They do look the same.
But they do have a different flower or leaf structure.
If you look at the real phlox, it has 5 petals. The ones that grow wild and take over all the countryside have 4 petals.
And those are the invasive ones.
Those are the invasive ones. Those are the horrible ones. But these nice ones blossom later in the year, like right now, and they have 5 petals. So they're odd, but they're lovely.
It's a nice way to identify them.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, the fleece plant behind you is pretty well done, and it's been flowering for at least a month, if not more.
Right. And this again started down way down at the bottom of the stem there at soil level, and this sprung up just this summer. This is in a little bit of shade, so it's not quite as huge as some of them get. And this is also a little bit younger one. So I'll be coming through here in the next day or so and cutting it back probably by half. And it will then flower a secondary time, not as huge as this time, but still enough to give us some flowers. These are balloon flowers. And they get that name because just before they blossom, they form this little balloon. It looks like a hot air balloon. Here's a white one, just ready to pop open. And when they pop open, they have this absolutely perfect star shape to them. Our sons and our grandson cannot help but come along and pop them. This one is a little too soft to pop. Let me find another one that'll pop. Oop, you see, it just lets the air out. That won't bother it. It'll still blossom, but they can't help themselves. We started out with blue ones. Somewhere along the way, we got a white one, which is over there. Here's one. And now we have pink ones also. So we know the bees have been busy. But they're lovely. They too, they're hardy. They don't require watering after they are established. They're self-sufficient. They will spread themselves by seeds and by roots, but they are not invasive. You can easily pull them out, get rid of them, move them if you like. Oh, there's a butterfly behind you. And they're lovely. They don't have a smell to them that I can smell, but the butterflies like them, and little boys like them. So, what more can I say?
I like them.
You like them too.
And I'm only 12.
That's right. Oftentimes you'll see coneflowers or echinacea. Yes, this is the echinacea people take when they think they're catching a cold. This is the common type that you'll see this time of year, mid-August, and it's just gorgeous. Last year we found an orange one. And this is how they start out. And then eventually get to be that
kind of get a
kind of head on
it. Cone head on there.
Right.
Yeah.
So, but it was just neat. I didn't know that it even came in another color. At the same time we bought this one, and this was also supposed to be an echinacea, but if it is, it's got a totally different flower. Yeah. So if any of you
definitely
know
variegated.
What that is, right. The leaf shape is the same, but the flower obviously is very different. But that's okay. Now this is called Joe Pieweed, I believe. I'm pretty sure it is. It too, perennial, takes care of itself, does not spread overly terribly. I do cut the heads off when they are done. Bees absolutely love them. Butterflies love them. If you have a problem with bees, then this is probably not something you want close to your door. But it's a very spectacular plant, very reliable. And behind it, you can see the
honeysuckle
vine that's been growing there now for maybe, 3 years?
Yep.
And doing very nicely. Again, honeysuckle doesn't seem to mind that it's in the shade. It'll also do very well in the sun. Now, this is an example of the giant fleece plant after it's had its hair cut. I cut this one down. This one was way over my head. Most of them were over my head when they were blossoming. And then they get so heavy they fall over and they start looking ugly. You can trim them back. You can see here's a stem that was definitely cut back. But you can see the secondary blossoms will come then and add a nice little white touch to the garden.
And you just cut this a couple days ago.
Yes, I cut it, I think 2 days ago, I cut it back. More sunflowers, and you can see that these are a little bit taller than I am. But you'll notice that the heads are not huge like they usually are. And that's okay. I mean, they're still gorgeous. And the animals and the critters love them. I see the goldfinch have been feasting on the heads that are finished, and that's always lovely because they're the same color. And there's more echinacea, bigger heads, the old-fashioned kind. Now, in an earlier tour, we talked about these lilies that had been given to us by Sharon a couple years back. They are still blossoming. Most of them are almost done, but some of them continue on. They're tough. They get hidden each year by daisies and grass that grows in here, but still they keep going. And Rick's favorite, tickweed, somehow managed to get from way over on that side of the yard over to this side. I'm guessing it's...
Thank you, little birdie.
The birdies, yes.
And bye bye, birdie.
If you had seen the video we did when we were chopping down this hedge that grows up each year, you can see that the hedge is also doing very nicely and will have to be chopped again. Hello, monarch.
Yeah, they are busy today.
Mm-hmm. Lovely.
I do love these spectacular displays. I mean, that is pretty amazing.
Another plant that has replanted itself is morning glory. It's sometimes hard to get them started because their seeds are so hard. But once they get going, if you're not vigilant in picking out each little vine as it starts, this is what will happen. There are sedum plants under here that are the size of the ones that are over there. 3 years ago, when we cut down 17 of our large trees, we kept the stumps as artistic aesthetic items in our garden. Well, this one just won't give up. This is an ash tree, and it just keeps on sprouting every year. I have to come in and cut it all back, and then you'll be able to see our aesthetic tree trunk. All of this whole thing. This could be an ash bush.
Well, we had the emerald ash borer in our area, and you could see how the trees were pretty dead. They had to come down, along with a couple of maples that were really in sad shape, too.
They're just very soft maples that break a lot.
Yeah.
We've replaced them. This is a quince, I believe, some kind of a quince tree or bush. Also, doesn't like to be contained, so that one will have to have its trimmings, too. This is one of our new baby peaches that we planted earlier this spring. We did not expect that it would have peaches, but sure enough, and some of them are getting so heavy that they're just breaking off. They're not quite ready. The color is right, but they're nice and hard, and they're not quite ready, so if they can stay on a little bit longer without damaging the tree, we're going to let them do that. And this is one of those silver maples we were talking about. Again, we left the stump. Again, we have trees that are trying to grow into new trees. Out come the loppers and away they go. Now here is a monarch butterfly that is on the milkweed pod, just like it's supposed to be. Now there's not a flower where that is, so either it's nibbling on there, although I don't think they have teeth, so maybe it's just rusting. Maybe it's tasting to see if that's the right kind of plant. With last year's severe winter and all the rabbit damage, we weren't sure whether our honeysuckle vines that were new last year would grow. This one's obviously having no problem, and it's mingling in with our grass, which makes a kind of a pretty picture.
Nice combination.
Mm-hmm. And then also we showed at the beginning of the year how horribly the rabbits had chewed down on our burning bushes. They have sprung back to life. How they keep doing that is beyond me, but there's another one over there.
Well, it's amazing because when we look at it in early spring, I mean, everything has been chewed off.
There's
everything.
Nothing. There might be something that's kind of like this left, when in the beginning of the season it would have been this tall.
I wish these would have a chance to grow and not be eaten.
Right, because when they are big, the rabbits seem to leave them alone. It's just when they're small like this, they must be delicious.
Yep.
I'm afraid this is going to be the amount of peaches that we get this year. This is just from this tree alone, but they are now being attacked, and I'm guessing it's from squirrels who are eating them right on the tree. So we're taking these in. We'll wrap them in tissue paper or newspaper and let them soften up as much as they're going to soften.
Yeah, seeing that our two big trees had no blossoms and no peaches this year.
Right. They will next year.
Yep.
One of our earlier tours, we talked about this plant, which is called the rattlesnake plant. I think it's a member of the yucca family, if I remember correctly. And this is the flower. This is as showy as it gets. Oftentimes you'll see these in dry bouquets because they are so stiff and beautiful to be mixed in with other flowers. And we just wanted to show you a quick update on what the container plantings have done. Elephant ear leaves are doing wonderfully. They like the shade. They seem to be doing okay, even though it's been rather cool for them. But we are really disappointed in these gladiolus. They haven't blossomed. They haven't even formed a blossom, and for whatever reason, they have this problem where they're either somebody's eating on these or something's happening, but they are not producing any flower whatsoever.
The only one that's produced is the one that's in the front in the railroad wheel.
Yes.
That's a tongue twister.
That one is producing flowers. These, none.
And I don't think it's because it's that shady back here.
No, because in the morning they get plenty of sun.
And they get plenty of water, mm-hmm. So...
But now remember, these are dahlias, the same variety, same packaging of dahlias that we saw over in the garden. Because they're in a container, perhaps, they are slower. They will be producing heads, but again, they're slower. So maybe it's... that they're in a container? I don't know.
It's got to be the weather, too.
Mm-hmm. Another one of my all-time favorites in the garden are these tea roses. They grow in clusters. They go until it freezes. It's just a constant blossoming, one after the other in little clusters. They're so brilliantly red. And just look at all of these that are ready to pop open. Last spring, there were so many canes that had been ruined by the harsh winter that we cut them way, way, way back. And
I thought you killed it.
And because they knew I loved them, so they came right back, and they're doing wonderfully.
True love.
Yep. Now I will be snipping off these old ones back to the next leaf I'll cut them back to here. And then that just gives the plant more chance to put out some more flowers, which I love. Another one of our free gifts from years past are these little alpine poppies or oriental little poppies. I planted a package of seeds one year, and they just plant themselves wherever they want, usually in this walkway. So they know I won't take them out because they're so beautiful, but they do kind of hide my stones.
And they drop their seeds.
So they assure themselves a place next year. Now this is the other fern leaf poppy, peony, or the Japanese peony. And we were trying to see if we could get some seeds from it. But again, like the one in the front, when you open them up, well, maybe those are the tiny, tiny little seeds. I'm so used to looking at the big peony seeds from the front. Well,
we'll still harvest them, but I can't guarantee that we're going to get anything, because I know several people who had asked if we would save seeds, and obviously that was part of our mission this year. But with this strange growing season we're experiencing here in Wisconsin, I mean, we had a terrible winter, an extremely cool spring, and then so much rain in June and July, over 15 inches.
Well, June, and then July was cool.
Yeah, I mean, it's barely even getting into the mid to high 70s.
Right. Now, this week is supposed to get back up into the 80s, but that's unpredictable. And we are not complaining, because we have not had floods. We have not had tornadoes. We have not had hurricanes or earthquakes.
Haven't had to run the air conditioner a whole lot this year.
Nope. So it's been pleasant as far as we're concerned, but some of the plants have to adjust to that condition and do the best they can.
I posted something on Facebook today. One of our favorite movie quotes is, "The oxen are slow, but the earth is patient."
Right.
From the movie High Road to China.
Right, with Tom Selleck.
Cool, Key Luke.
And Key Luke said that.
Yes. Yeah.
He was the wise one. Yep, so.
I mean, we'll do our best to try to harvest seeds, but, we can't make any guarantees that we're going to have any the way things are going right now.
Well, last year I was looking for maple seeds, and there weren't a whole lot of maple seeds, and then this spring there were maple trees growing everywhere, so how they managed
by the millions
is beyond me. And these are the dahlias that we planted. In an earlier video, we planted all sorts of lilies in here, oriental lilies, and the rabbits just chewed them to pieces. Fortunately, they didn't like dahlias, and so they are doing fantastically. I mean, this one's getting to be as tall as I. If you want them to continue to blossom longer, I would suggest that you want to deadhead them. That means take off the blossoms that are old, take it down so that it's not an unsightly stump left over, and then just put these on the compost pile. I can't help myself, just a minute. There we go. And that way it'll clean up the plant while you're looking at it, but it'll also encourage it to keep on trying to make seeds, which you of course are not going to let it do. But the plant doesn't know that. It just says, I need to make some more flowers because I need some more seeds. So it'll just keep blossoming, and these will go until the fall. So these are lovely. And there's different kinds, obviously. This is more like a daisy, and this is more like a honeycomb. Absolutely gorgeous. And there is a beautiful pink one.
I like all the colors. I was expecting them to be shorter.
Well, like those.
Yeah. Different, different variety.
Mm-hmm. So they do what they want to do.
But these all started as bulbs, and now you're going to have to dig these up in fall?
Yes. These have to come up in the fall. The lilies do not, and I hope that there was enough life left in the lily bulbs that they can do something for next year, but only time will tell, and we may fence this little area in so that the rabbits will not have access next spring.
Well, rabbit or deer, we don't know which yet.
I'm guessing rabbit for this time. Bye for now. If you enjoyed the tour, please give us a thumbs up. Thank you so much for watching. And if you have comments or questions, or if you want to share what's happening in your garden, we'd love to hear from you. And we'd like to have you join our garden family and subscribe. Always good to have people that like to garden.